Thank you, everyone, for coming for this special grand rounds that we have over here today. It is my honor to introduce you to both of our speakers tonight. We're going to have Paul Ehrlich and Sandra Kahn. So they're both authors of a book, JOS, The Story of a Hidden Epidemic. That was a book that we got in our sleep world, if you will. A good amount of attention and discussion and a good number of patients coming to the clinic to actually discuss the findings of this book. And it shed some light on this somewhat still to be developed field of facial growth in pediatric facial growth. So it is definitely something that we need. And they brought a lot of attention and data and theories for this topic. So I'm delighted to have both of them. Paul is an emeritus professor of here at Stanford. He's a professor of population studies, and he's the president of the Center for Conservation Biology. He is a member of the National Academy of Sciences. He's received a number of awards on this field, including the Crawford Prize, what it seems to be the Nobel Prize in the fields of science that is related to this. So he's becoming much of this effort and attention that he's getting now, it is for this airway and dental facial and craniofacial development that got his attention. Most due to his work and dialogue and talks with Sandra Kahn, who is the co-author of the book with him. So Sandra is a graduate from the University of Mexico, University of Pacific in dentistry. And she has a wealth of clinical experience in craniofacial growth, and she calls herself a recovery orthodontist. She's going to explain that, what that means exactly. And so she is currently working more on, Sandra, correct me if I'm wrong, but braceless orthodontics with the method of good oral posture and exercises, GOPEX, and oral posture. Sandra and Paul, thank you again for joining us, and I'm excited to have you and looking forward to hear more about this.
Thank you very much. I guess a place to start is how come an evolutionary biologist and an orthodontist have been working closely together, although I think both of us consider it something that should happen much more in the fields of public health, but we actually both started out in conservation biology. That's where we met because my closest colleagues working in conservation biology and the general environmental problems are Mexican, including a faculty member at Stanford, Rodolfo Dierzo, who is a member of the National Academy of Sciences, Gerardo Ceballos at UNAM, who's also a member of the American National Academy of Sciences, and several other people in Mexico, where I'll be moving soon if the election goes in the wrong direction, and helping to build the wall to keep the gringos out. Anyway, Sandra was very much involved with Gerardo. Sandra and her husband, David, who is not Mexican, but was raised in Mexico and runs a wonderful set of eco resorts, had been working with Gerardo on cougar conservation at Calakmul. Since Gerardo spends a lot of time at Stanford, he introduced us to Sandra and David, who live very close to us at Stanford. And we discovered a joint interest in fermented grape juice, which I recommend to anybody in these days. And in our conversations, Sandra embarrassed me greatly by asking me questions about how come most kids now have their mouths full of metal and most of us have so-called wisdom teeth, unerupted third molars, and what's going on? How come? Why do we have sleep apnea as a really important stressor in a world already full of stressors? And my embarrassment was that it never occurred to me. I've had a long interest in public health issues. I've been writing about global change and the epidemiological environment, which of course there are many connections. And so we started thinking about it. And what became the basic answer, which I will, to the basic problem I'll give you now, is the same as the one with many of the so-called diseases of civilization, be they diabetes, obesity, heart disease, cancers, and so on. Many of them trace, at least in part, to bringing our Stone Age genes into a basic McDonald's kind of environment. One of the sad things, if you check the web and you check malocclusion, crooked teeth, virtually every site, places like Medline and so on, say that it's hereditary. Now, first of all, hopefully, all of you know that the very statement that something is genetic shows that it's nonsensical. It's a nonsensical explanation because everything, even including the shape of your hands and whether you're colorblind or that sort of thing, has all of our phenotypic characteristics are a result of an interaction between our genetic code and the environment, which includes the things that like myelination and not myelinization, excuse me. Just had a senior moment. Don't worry about it. I got dementia like everybody else. It's like saying, when you say something is caused by genetics, it's like saying that the area of a rectangle is caused by the length of the rectangle or the width. You cannot say that. You can say that the size of the rectangle is changing, that the area of the rectangle is caused by a change in the length or a cause in the width, but you cannot say the area of the rectangle is caused by genetics. That's number one. Number two, of course, is that, as we all know, evolution goes on generation time. The basic problem, which causes the problems with the teeth, is the shrinkage of the human jaw. It's been going on gradually since roughly the time of the agricultural revolution, say 8,000-9,000 years ago. But it's gone on rapidly over the last few hundred years. And the last few hundred years is a handful of generations. So even if there was a selection pressure for reducing the size of the human jaw, there's not been anywhere near the level of selection that could possibly cause it. If for example, every generation since 300 years ago, the length of human jaws, the size of human jaws was measured, and we killed the 98% of people with the longest jaws, only breeding from those 2% with the shortest jaws, then we might have caused the kind of shrinkage we see. But examining historic records, it turns out we haven't been killing 98% of the people with longer jaws. So we know automatically that change in our genetics cannot be responsible largely for the shrinkage of the jaws. Some people occasionally say it may be due to genetic drift. As you'll all remember, genetic drift is random changes in our genotypes in small, very small populations. And what we're seeing is directional change in our jaws in huge populations. Anytime the huge population adopts Western diets, for example, the jaws tend to shrink. That doesn't mean that the diet is necessarily the entire cause or even a cause of the shrinkage, but what it tells you is the shrinkage of the human jaws is caused primarily by environmental factors. And Sandra will talk much more about that, because it raises a whole series of interesting questions about causation, which are tied to very interesting questions in human development, in epigenetics and things like that, because we don't really understand as well as we should how the signaling from cell to cell and from tissue to tissue and so on determines the growth of the entire facial head complex. There are, again, theories on this, but at the biochemical level and the molecular biology level, it's still partially mysterious. After all, the very most basic question in development in multicellular organisms is how come when you start out with exactly the same genetic code in the zygote that then is in the two cells when the zygote divides and so on, how does that all eventually lead to the complexities of hemopoiesis, for example, that many of you probably studied in immunology and saw that how extraordinarily different cell lines can become, how rapidly they can change, and so on. We understand some of the detail, but we don't understand as well some of the more macro things, like what determines how is the size of your jaw actually controlled? How is it related to the entire skull? We have ideas, but that's about all. So the basic thing that I would like to communicate to you is, first of all, the mouth, the throat, the nose, the joint between the mouth, the lower jaw, and the skull, and so on, are extremely important to all people interested in medicine. There are all sorts of critical issues there that apply not only to all the things that follow sleep apnea and how sleep apnea ought to be treated and how it can be treated, but they also tie in some ways to the totally bungled handling of the SARS-CoV-2 virus pandemic that we're now facing. Hopefully you all know that's probably the most disgraceful bungling of any public health issue ever in the history of humanity. And the issues that are involved by ENTs, otolaryngologists, can have an impact there, just like the issues that interest conservation biologists can. 25 years ago, I was writing with Gretchen Daly in our department and following other people about the huge threats of wet markets in China as a result of lack of conservation of many animals and the existence of wet markets and of the duck pig pond complex that's essentially set up to generate nasty viruses for us. If you end up with COVID-19, you may end up needing to be intubated. And what's one of the questions there? Should you add extra nitric acid to the intubation system? We don't understand well enough exactly where the nitric acid, which can help you a great deal in some situations with viral infection of the lungs, but we don't know the way we ought to know how much of it comes from your maxillary sinuses and how much of it is endogenous from the NO synthase in the linings of the arterioles. So there's lots of places where there's a connection between standard problems faced by physicians in this area and evolutionary biologists. And I'll finish my little rant and turn it over to Sandra by pointing out that if we were more holistic, we would have data that we need but can't get our hands on. For example, when Sandra and I have been working on this problem with colleagues, there's a real paucity of data. We don't know the proportion of people of various ages that have sleep apnea. We don't know the sizes of human jaws over most of the world. What we know about shrinkage comes from recent excavations of graveyards in places like Denmark in comparison of the remains with modern Danes, that sort of thing. But what we need is more tying together so that physicians and dentists and evolutionary biologists and epidemiologists work together more closely. Just think if we had what data you would have and we would have about jaws and jaw joints and those things, if the Framingham study had included just a few questions on these topics. In other words, some areas of physicians and other people like Sandra and I that are interested in these problems don't get represented in a lot of the big data gathering efforts, and they should be. We're sadly ignorant of a lot of things that are really critical to ENTs. But of course, all of us are interested in what the hell we do, A, about individuals which have the problems that are faced by dentists and orthodontists and ENTs, and also what should we do about society to help them to understand that, for example, sleep apnea is a horrendous stressor. And if there's anything there's a huge literature on, it's the negative effects of stress on the life histories of individual human beings. So we have a lot of work ahead of us, and we have, I think, a huge need to talk more between us, which is one of the reasons I'm inflicting myself on you this evening. And I appreciate your patience. And I'll now turn it over to Sandra, who knows much more about all of these things that I do. And like Kamala Harris, she's a dominant woman. So here she is. Maybe she went back to sleep. It's 3 a.m. where she is.
No, I'm here. I'm going to go into the presentation so I don't take so much of your time. So basically, the most important thing for me is to build a teamwork so that we can work and reach and take our patients where we need to go. This is a list that I put of the people that I've been standing on their shoulders. So I'm going to rush through this part so that I can spend a little time. I've been in Germany working with Dr. Engelke, who is an ENT, and he's an ENT, a maxillofacial surgeon, and a phonoaudiologist. He has 3 PhDs, and he has incredible research. I've been reading his first article in 2007, and I've been looking for him for a long time. And I finally was able to come over here and do a couple. I just spent 2 weeks with him, and we're going to be doing a lot of interesting research. So let's just talk a little bit of, the audience. I might have more physicians than orthodontist. So I just going to rush a little bit about our history, which is really important so that we know exactly where we're going. And so Dr. Engel started our profession, and he certainly talked about the airway and the importance of development. So he basically, from 100 years ago, he already told us that functional disorders are most importantly needed to be addressed in order to be able to have a successful orthodontic treatment. So I called myself a recovered orthodontist because we have forgot that this in orthodontics. We deal with the symptoms, we deal with the braces, which are patching up the problems. Then we have doctors like Enlo, who gave us the compendium on growth, and the orthodontist should be the authorities in growth and development. So we need to get back to that. And in his book, Enlo, in his studies, he said that a healthy face develops around a healthy airway. And this is, he's repeated that. So it's been part of our research. Harvard at UCSF did their research with the monkeys where he blocked the top of the mouth. He did a lot of stuff, and this was one of his studies. He blocked the top of the mouth where the tongue couldn't get to the roof, and that resulted in collapse of the jaw. Then we know that early treatment hasn't been successful. For many years, I used to talk to Dr. Gaming Noll, and he would say, you know, we need early treatments, but we need successful treatments. And we know that what we call orthopedics, the special orthopedics with young children, is not working, because all we're doing is we're anchoring from one jaw. And Dr. Johnson has shown this very clearly. He's the conscience of the orthopedic profession, or he looks at the research and lets us know what has worked over the years. And orthopedic with little children hasn't worked because it hasn't really addressed the problem. McNamara, another big name, he talked about the upper jaw being back in almost all patients, including the patients that have an overbite or a class two. So the maxillofacial retrusion, it's common in almost everybody in the Western world. And this is why I call myself a recovered orthodontist, because if we look at the Cochrane collaboration, we can see that orthodontic treatment has time and time shown not to have enough evidence to be substantiated by evidence. And we know about extraction treatments, and we also know that our treatments are not stable, and there's sufficient evidence for everything we do. Then we go into the posture, which has been significant in our profession. And when I talk about posture, I always have to talk about the fact that the body is a unit, so we can't talk about body posture without talking about mouth posture. And when we look at the mouth, we have studied like MOSS or theories like MOSS functional matrix that explains that the matrix of the soft tissue will guide the hard tissue. And the matrix of the jaws is the tongue. So in these cuts, we can see that if we keep the tongue low, it's not going to sit in the palate. So the palate is not going to develop. And the tongue will sit between the molars at rest, which is where we spend most of our time. So there won't be a closed system that can develop the mouth. The brain works as a function matrix by expanding inside the cavity that was closed. And then we get the bone growth around that. So if the mouth is kept low, we don't have that closed circuit. So we need to have the tongue high and touching the full roof of the mouth. But if we don't, if we don't have our teeth together, then the circuit breaks up. So this is very important to understand. I'm just going to rush through a little bit of the anthropology side, which Dr. Ehrlich talked about it. But we know that the problem that we're seeing with the shrinkage of jaws is not genetic. This is one of my patients, biological father, mother. And that in our patient that has been working with posture. So we can see that we can very easily change the phenotype of the jaw. And, you know, this is a daughter that has had, you know, posture treatment as opposed to the mom that just had orthodontic treatment. So we've had enough research in this area, and we know that this is a problem that is affecting the whole of humanity, mostly in areas that are industrialized. So we've been publishing on this for a long time, and you guys will have the article in that. But we need to understand what's normal in order to be able to gear our treatments towards that. And we know that overbites are not normal, but there have been selection pressures that have taken off to develop the overbites. And speech has been one of them, because if we look at speech, the groups that could communicate better, more completely, we're able to survive. So the overbite helped us pronounce some sounds. So, and this happens also with the tongue. So we know that this is from a museum from the time that we already had photographs. This is what we were talking about with functional metrics. Okay, so this is the girl that has had treatment compared to her parents. This is the overbite that we've had a natural selection that has favored it. So that there's things that have favored the creation of an overbite, but ideally, and this skull from a museum is part of a collection on Hold on, I can't see my cursor. Okay. So, hold on just a second here. Okay, I can't see my cursor, so anyway. So this specimen is from the time that we already have photographs. So this is, we know it's less than 200 years old. And we can see the angulation of the incisors is quite different. I'm not lecturing the orthodontist, but we know that these x-rays that are taken are very different than the standards that we've had for our profession. And I've been collecting photographs from people that have had no crowding and no orthodontic treatment, and they have their complete dentition. And I've been looking at the measurements, and it's interesting how these people have an incredible, their histories, health histories are very healthy, and they most of them have an end-to-end overbite. They don't have the typical orthodontic results. So I'm looking at these cases and trying to figure out what's normal. This is not normal. We know that children should be able to have the diastemas around 4 or 5 years old. We should be able to pass a coin to our contact. So we need to see what's normal. This is one of Dr. Wong's patients. I'd like to show her because with just a very short round of expansion and posterior treatment, we can change the direction of where she's going. And this is her dental arches, where we can see that we can put them very early in life in the right path by doing a little bit of architecture work with their jaws and changing their posture. We can see at the bottom, the tongue has so much more room and is happier after we've had the expansion. So, and these kids come back just for photographs, and they don't need any treatment. So years pass, and their teeth start erupting with a good space. So this is just a treatment where patients, we can follow them and see that they're not needing any symptoms relief. So let's get into the heart of my presentation, because I've been spending time with Dr. Engelke. This is one of his studies, one of the first studies that I looked at, and he looked at the position of the tongue. And he wrote, came up with something he calls the tongue repositioning maneuver. And it's very, very interesting because he's the first person or first scientist that I saw that talked about a position of the tongue that is not based on voluntary movement. He doesn't tell the patient to put the tongue actively somewhere. He taught them how to generate the negative pressure in the mouth so that the tongue is stable, and it's stable without as a reflex. So when we sleep, the tongue can be stable. So I just spent 2 weeks with him looking at MRIs, and he's doing amazing research. And it's worth for everybody to look at his work, because I think it has implications in all of medicine. But here, the tongue position maneuver is used to achieve a closed, what he calls a biofunctional rest position of the orofacial system, and re-educate the nasal breathing pattern. This is very critical because in sleep apnea, sleep disorders, or growth, guidance, like I do, this can bring everything forward. So we had him working with Nocel. Engelke is the head of, he's retired, but he was the head of the Department of Maxillofacial Surgery at Göttingen University for over 20 years. And he worked with Nocel, who's his orthodontist, and they measured these stresses, which is very, very critical. They measured. If we can't measure, we can't improve it. So they came up with a system to measure, and we are working on a better system that I will make available to ENTs very, very soon. But, you know, he definitely worked with all the things that orthodontists have been working on. And we talked about the swallow. This is another study of his. This 2016, where he compared the forces in swallowing, the tongue posture, in different types of malocclusion. And this is very interesting because they established that if you have a malocclusion, if you have a class two, if you have a narrow jaw, you could not achieve this position, no matter how much you try. So this is where, you know, working in teams where we can get those expansions early, expansion with adults. I'll show you a system that we're using with expansion. I have a couple cases going with Dr. Liu next month on these techniques. to get that situation where we can't achieve this. So if you can't measure it, you cannot improve it. So this is why I'm spending time in Germany, and this is why I'm working with pressures. And this has been incredibly eye-opening because nobody has looked at this before. He talks about four compartments, and I'm going to explain in detail his bifunctional model because I think it's critical that we understand what we haven't looked at in the past so that we can change that and look at it for the future. And these are two spaces that we can see here. At the top of the palate, this is a very important space. It's called, he calls it the donor space because of the first doctor in 1875. 1875, 150 years ago, this space and the pressure in this space is already described. And then we have the Franco space on the side. But let me show you what he's talking about. This is Dr. Engelstein, his clinic. And these are all the things that he's doing to measure. This is one of the systems that we have to train patients. We're going to make this available at some point. I'm trying to get him to do this. No financial interest for me, but I think this information needs to be looked at. He's doing endoscopy, but endoscopy has a lot of limitations. So he's now working with a high-definition MRI with 50 images per second. And this is what he published, but he's advanced from this. But I think it's very important that we look at this, and we look at, there's actually seven positions to close our mouth. But these are the three basic ones. And when we have a mouth that at night is resting with lips apart and the palate apart, I don't know if you guys can see it in your screen, but we can see that the tongue is kept low and in the top. And then in the bottom, what he calls semi-open condition, the lips are closed. And we have a lot of interest right now to, you know, put some tape over the lips and close the lips. And everybody thinks that the lips is where the magic is, but it's not really there. It's really on what he calls the valves, closing the valves. The lips is just one of the seven valves in the mouth. So I'll go through that, but this diagram is very important for us to remember and show our patients and understand what's going on, because a closed mouth doesn't mean the lips are closed. And that last at the bottom, which he calls like closed condition with negative pressure. You can see the pressure and you can see all the forces imbalanced. And this should happen in a way that is auto-sustained. So it's not a voluntary position. It's a position that's held by holding that negative pressure on. So he calls it closed compartment with negative pressure. And this is critical because if you can learn this position, and he now has devices that can help us teach patients if they are keeping the, and when I say now, I mean 2007, he already had these devices. So he's been measuring this for a long time. And if we can teach patients how to generate this negative pressure, we will be able to hold all the tissues forward. And in girls, this will stimulate forward growth, but even in patients that are fully grown, it will keep the airway open. And Dr. Engelke has one of his PhDs was done on the velopalatini. So the back of the throat has been his interest for many years, even before he was a maxillofacial surgeon. He was looking at what the vellum was doing. And I'm going to show this part of this video, not the whole thing, but this is the stuff that you can see.
Ich nütz es gern in alle Rinden ein.
That we all go to right after we follow, but we only hold it for a few seconds. And through this work, I've become in love with the valpalatine because it keeps an acrobat. This muscle, the way it works with the levator of the palatini and what the constrictor in the back of the throat does, it is an incredible dance or spectacle when you actually look at it in the high definition MRI. So I'm going to go through this very quickly because it's important what we've looked at in the past. These are 9 images that we chose of what we know about we call it the nasal oral facial complex. Now we're writing a new book called Nose with a brilliant ENT. So we got to see that the figure 9 is profit, which is what the orthodontists look like. And we can see how much of what's going on really in the mouth is missing. And Prophet, one of the fathers of orthodontics, he knew that there were forces in the mouth. He's looking at muscular forces, and the only thing he depicted was the tongue and the lip. Then we have in the 80s, the figure 3 is what the Gardner started myofunctional therapy, started showing as their diagram. And we can see that there's nothing. The back of the throat is empty. And we can see that there's no contact of the valpalatini with the tongue. So this is, if you don't draw it, then you're not going to pay attention to it. Then we have number 2 is what the speech pathologist, phonologist work with. They don't put attention to the back. The valpalatini is just sitting in the air, and they're just thinking of the sound and the air. Then we have the typical cadaver views that are hollow because they're dealing with a dead tongue. So, you know, they're not going to show what's going on with the muscle. We have 6 is from near, which is netter, or however you pronounce it. And we know that we use a lot of his diagrams for my books. I always go back to his anatomy. And, you know, you can see that the valpalatine is just in the middle. So when you don't know what to do with something, you just, you know, you go in between. You don't put it on one side or the other. And we know maxillofacial surgeons. This is one of the interesting diagrams that we found in an oral surgery book. And it's the first time that we see that there's some pressure differential. You know, it's a very basic diagram, not a lot of anatomy, but it's from someone that understands that there's pressures of the air going into the nose and there's a negative pressure in the mouth. So this is the first one. It's very crude, but at least it's recognizing what we have. And then we have number 8, which is what the dentists are looking at, which is we look at teeth, and this is looking at the air and the advance, the splints to advance, and we're looking at protrusions. So we don't really see any of these being accurate to have a diagram so we can start speaking the same language. This is a little bit of the history. This is a lecture that's really about 4 hours long that I'm rushing through. But working with Dr. Paul Ehrlich and his team, I know that we have to understand where we're coming from to know where we're going. And, you know, from 1873 with Donner, 1953 with Eck and Mobius, who described these two spaces and their pressures, to Frankel, who developed some appliances but already did some work in the 50s with students teaching them how to generate the pressure. And then we have Prophet, who talked about the balance of forces in his equilibrium theory. So we have all this in our history. And Dr. Engelke created, he published 2009, his own model of what he called the biofunctional model of respiration. And here we can see the structures and the complex. And very critical is that donor space that will hold that pressure. And these are, you know, as I said before, this is a very long lecture that I want to do, and I will invite you guys to join when we do it, because we have to talk about the 12 functional units that he talked about, the muscle groups that work and how they work together. And then he talks about 7 valves that close off 4 compartments. And I'm going to show you a little bit of what this means. Spend some time only in the valve, because the whole body works with valve. And the pressure differential. know from the CPAPs and all the things that we're doing that we are looking at pressures. So we can understand how the pressures are generated and how the valves open and close in different situations in the mouth. So these are the 12 units that he's talking about, and these are the valves. I'm just going to go through them very quickly, but it's very important that we understand that these are valves that open and close, and some of them in the audience may be ENTs, so you probably understand it much better than me. I'm just repeating what I've been working on the last week, but we know valve number one is the lips. They can be open, they can be closed. In this picture, we see that they're open. Then we have the space number two, which includes the cheeks, and we can see that it has the palate, the heart palate, the other processes, part of the tongue. It's hard to define this space, but it can be closed off and it can have negative pressure. And then we have space three that we can't really see it well when we open, but it has the tongue, the soft palate, and the hard palate. And it can vary in different functions. Then space number four, we can see that it's the valve can be seen endoscopically. We can't see it with it directly. But endoscopy has its limitations, but we can observe these valves, and we should understand how they open and close so that we can create the best exercises and best situations for our patients to rest in. So let's see this video, which is just an excerpt of the one I showed, just showing the swallow, because the swallow is one of the functions that ends up in that physiological position. Important to understand that now that we've been working with MRI, these are positions where you're supine. So it's going to be different for a patient that's swallowing normally. We're going to have, this is just a hand-drawn picture of how the donor space would look if we were standing up. But you can see how, first of all, what constrictor starting to take over to help bring down the bolus. And this, I'm not going to go in detail because I want to leave some time for questions, but this is very interesting. Once you see the video, you can pause it and then you can look at the valve 1-7 and with Mark, you know, in each part of the swallow, I've just done screenshots of each part of the swallow so we can see what's going on as the bolus passes through the mouth, and we can see that the positions of the, especially the deltopalatinum elevates and how it closes towards the tongue and how the constrictor has a job in bringing down the bolus. But you can see we've pretty much marked how the valves open and close. In this here, the we use pineapple juice, and you know it goes into a very small tube. So this is why this valve is open, but it should be closed. And you know, so you can see how all these valves open and close, which is incredible because now we can talk about this position without having any doubt that this is just an opinion. We can see it physically, and if we can see it physically, we can teach the patients how to hold this pressure. And they've been doing some research with horn players at the Max Planck Institute in Göttingen, which we work with too. And the physicists are doing work to see how they can improve their situation. And it's incredible. When they show a horn player the position that he's doing, what he's doing wrong, he can immediately correct it. Where we can, you know, in the future, if we can show this to patients, we can achieve that position that will help us keep the airway open towards the back and keep that space with negative pressure. And it's very critical. One example that we use is if you take a syringe and you put your finger in the tip and you try to open the syringe, you can't because you create that pressure that doesn't allow the movement. So if we create that in the mouth, if that donor space has the correct pressure generated, then we're going to be able to hold that tongue without any effort and sleep all night with an open airway. this is a, I'm going to just close with one of the practical stuff that we're looking into. And we do have an exercise program, and we have an appliance that helps us determine and show the patient, give them feedback of where their tongue is. But we need to understand what Dr. Liu has published already about the causality of the airway. And I'm working right now with Dr. Ferenc Hernandez and Fire and Spain with the surgery protocol. This is a protocol that we're using with young adults to be able to achieve that expansion in adults so that we can actually generate that negative pressure. Because if we don't have this through the research that's done, we know that we can't help our patients. And I'm not going to show this video, but the procedure is...
un video en tiempo real.
The video is real time. I'm happy sharing it with you guys. It's 10 minutes to get the... maybe I have to show part of it.
Un video en tiempo real. En tiempo real quiere decir que va...
Put in this appliance, screw it. It's done in surgery, so the earth doesn't have to do much. These expanders are custom made.
No customizados, no es muy buena.
In a 3D printer, so they're made for them, so they're very, very, very successful. And then the incision, the surgery, is done in a minimal invasive way. He's published this already, so you know you guys can go back. He's got, I think, over
5
patients in his updated study of how he goes into a small incision. And what
poco
he calls minimally invasive or SAMARPE, which is surgically assisted mini anchorage supported rapid maxillary expansion. So he goes in 10 minutes, it's real, all done in real time, and he helps us achieve what we need with the patients so that we can guide them to have a successful result.
Okay, so ortodoncia.
This is one of my patients. This is how we plan it. We plan exactly where the meniscus goes. So it's a very novel technique because we can do everything digitally, and then we can print the expanders and design them exactly the way we want it and have very few side effects. Every time we throw appliances on the teeth, we're going to have side effects that we have to counteract. So this is something we do. And I will finish my presentation by just talking about our new book. And Dr. Ehrlich already talked a little bit about nitrous oxide, but this is our new book with Dr. Jesus Raquel Chavez, an ENT, brilliant ENT. And we are writing about the stuff on the nose, because of nitrous oxide. And this has become very, very important in our current environment with COVID and all the viral stuff. This is current research from 2020 that's actually looking at nitric oxide and how it can help us in our mitigation of this viral situation that we're living right now. And these are just two articles that I published. I've helped a little bit with, and it just shows that this is an ongoing thing that we're trying to measure. And the nose has to be free at night, especially in the child. It's part of another presentation, but it's very important for me to underline that when we sleep, it's a different system than when we're awake. 95% of the air needs to go through the nose effortless, because there's so much going on at night, especially in growing children, that we have to make a priority of the nose. And there's a hierarchy in what we do, and nose goes first. Respiration, breathing is ideal, and then we need to work on other things, and then we can work on sleep. But nose is critical to what we call alveolize the air and get the right situation so that our brain can be free at night and we can have the best possible position. This is an example that Dr. Jesus Raquel was using with us. He takes an ejector, and if you close one side, then the ejection is very successful. So the tip is, it would be the nose, and the base is the mouth. So if you keep that negative pressure and everything is nice and locked in the mouth, then the inspiratory effort is going to be minimal. And we have to focus on this where we can create this position as a team with our patients and work for a common goal. With that, I'm going to disconnect, and I might have left very little time for questions, but I'm happy to entertain questions with the audience.
Sandra, that was great. That was really, really good. So I want to see if anyone on the PEDS group has any questions. Hello? Hello, Sandra, do you hear me? Hello?
I think she went back to sleep.
Okay, I think Sandra is having some issues there. So no, this is very interesting. I think we definitely need more knowledge on what is the normative data, what is considered to be normal or abnormal on craniofacial growth. We definitely need more normative data there in research and this interaction in between the functional part, but plus we are surgeons, so plus the surgical part. So how can we go beyond that, and how can we actually interact more with those theories of how orthodontists and speech language pathologists can foster adequate craniofacial growth? Again, I think that is a great field that both of you are tapping into. And I think perhaps a good first step would be to think, what is normal? Again, what is the normal craniofacial growth values, considering all, again, different phenotypes and craniofacial types that you can think of. So as Alan just pointed out here, because there perhaps are some ethnic differences on jaw sizes compared to in between ethnic groups, how can we establish normative values for those, and how can we explain those differences?
Well, that's one of the things that getting a more holistic approach and talking to each other more could help. I mean, because that's one of the things that we desperately need to know, and they're not getting the data. This Engelke's work really impresses me, because got to remember, I'm an amateur at all of this or less, but I've always learned that it's the slow pressures and so on that change bones. The famous examples being things like foot binding in China, or various groups that try and elongate and successfully elongate their children's heads by binding them to boards and so on while they're being carried. And most of the early attention, and in fact, my attention and Sandra's to a degree, was are the jaws shrinking because we're eating a liquid diet? In other words, one of the huge changes is, even when was the last time any of you chewed a steak? They virtually fall apart in your mouth now. Almost everything we do doesn't involve chewing. And so the thought was, because of Harvold's experiments and work by Lieberman and others, that the shrinkage of the jaws must be because they're not getting the exercise. But that doesn't fit with what we know about what changes bones. And I think Engelke has brought in a really good clue, because if you have a negative pressure holding your tongue against your palate, you can sleep with it. It doesn't require any effort on your part. And at the same time, you're applying the kind of gradual pressure that helps to shape the entire skull. Just like if you have a tight bracelet on and then keep it on for 30 years and then cut your arm off and look at your bone, you'll find a dent where the bracelet was. So the Engelke stuff has really, from my point of view, broken loose a really important thing for us all to think about. But I wish we'd think about also making the measurements so that the issue of how much smaller, say, proportionally jaws of Asiatic peoples are to, say, European people, we'd actually have some data to look at.
That's fascinating. That's excellent. That's very good.
I think there's already reasonably good data. Simon Wong here. A banker did some studies with Floresmia in India, and she measured normal arches with good dentition alignment in natural, naturally straight subjects. And, you know, they found intermolar widths that were very consistent to indicate how much room there should be in a palate when there's good dentition of natural alignment. Bjork's work on his implant studies on growth, and you tie that in with Bushang's work, Wang's work, where they did the evaluation of the growth, Michigan growth groups and the Bolton groups. We have very, very solid data. It's just that it's a little bit older and people have just forgotten that it's there. So there's been a tremendous amount of historical data back in a time where malocclusions were a lot less. You know, my grandparents had perfectly straight teeth. My parents had really good straight teeth. I've got slightly crowded teeth. And all the kids I treat today have horrendous malocclusions. I mean, I'm not just talking about 5%, 10% of the population. I'm talking about 60% of the population walking through the door have no room for their wisdom teeth, have skeletal malocclusions. So,
Perhaps you can tell us a bit more about your experience. Where are you working?
I'm in Melbourne, Australia.
Okay.
And
He looks a lot like Simon Wong, who's a very famous dentist, who's doing great work.
Okay, excellent.
It's that funny cap he's got on that makes it difficult to identify him.
That's excellent. Anybody else has any questions? So Sandra, Paul, I wanted to thank you for this presentation. We are on the time limit here almost. This was very enlightening. What I hope is that this spurs some further research that we can explore some more on all those factors and all these factors and deepen the knowledge in craniofacial growth. I think it is a much needed field that has a lot to grow within the next the next years, and how we actually draft interventions, how do we draw interventions, how do we learn more about how to change and how to improve. This is what we are seeing. All of us are having kids who are being path expanders or so how can we actually change that would be fantastic. We have here quite a strong team with Tulio Valdez and Alan Chang, our team that is dealing with complex sleep apnea in the pediatric population, that they're doing a tremendous job. So that would be great to foster some more of that academic development. And we have Stanley Yu as well, working quite a bit on skeletal surgery, mostly in adults, but as well now starting working a bit more with the pediatric and teenager population. So that would be great if we can talk some more.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your
patience. It's been a pleasure.
It's always a pleasure to see you. Yeah. Take care, Paul.
Yeah, you too.
Sandra,
don't breathe the air.
We can use some masks here. Bye-bye. Thank you all.